Okay, listen up, guys. Listen up. Listen up. In every football game, there'll be a time in the game when adversity will strike. Something goes wrong, pull together, be together, be one, be the team. Okay, and kick their ass. Kick their ass. Let's go.
Well, the Thundering Herd from Marshall University riding a 31-game winning streak heading into the season opener tonight against Southeast Missouri.
Hey, listen up. Great half. Great half.
It's interesting to note that head coach Bob Pruitt himself played here back in the 60s, and he came back here to lead this team to heights that many thought were not possible. Hard to believe how far this team has come in the past 30 years.
DC-9 Southern Airways plane carrying Marshall University's football team, rooters, and crew crashed and burned in moderate rain and fog in West Virginia. Once again, this late story just in, plane crash in West Virginia. That according to state police and the FAA.
Good evening. A chartered jet carrying the Marshall University football team home to West Virginia crashed as it tried to land at the Huntington Airport. All 75 persons aboard were killed. It was the worst plane crash in the United States this year.
You know, once it went down, it was 30 seconds. They didn't have much time to do anything.
She just said, I just heard that this plane came in. She said, is that the one that Parker was on? And I was like, I know that I just couldn't answer.
Here was these guys that I lost, and then I started saying, you know, well, I should have been there. I should have died when they died.
No school in the country went through as big a tragedy as Marshall did.
That, as far as Marshall was concerned, was the dawning of the Marshall we have today.
No other team in football, college football, won more games than Marshall University throughout the 90s.
It's too good to be true. You know, you completely lose a football team and then you go and win a national championship. That can't be how it came about. It's the most unbelievable sports story never told.
Hi, I'm Steve Cyphers, and welcome to this ESPN Classic Sports Center flashback presentation. Think of Marshall University, and you think of Randy Moss, Chad Pennington, and a winning record. Hard to imagine, then, that in the late 60s, before it was known, the school brought in a group of players who could have put Marshall on the map much earlier. This is Old Fairfield Stadium, where the Thundering Herd used to play. This is their story, and what remains the worst tragedy in the history of American sports.
I was in high school. My senior year was 1968. School was very small, but we had some very, very good athletes. I played high school football, I played baseball, and ran track. But football was my forte, so I was recruited heavily in football. I happened to make the All-Star game, and we were playing in Orlando. And some guy had asked me if I wanted to consider coming to Marshall. Well, to me, I'd never heard of Marshall. I had heard of West Virginia because all I could think of in West Virginia was hillbillies. And I said, and so when I told my friends that, some guy had asked me if I wanted to make a visit to Marshall. He said, why do you want to go to visit those hillbillies? And I said, well, I don't know, but it's just somewhere different. I was born and raised in Quincy, Florida, in a rural area on a tobacco farm. There were generations that had come up just like they do in the slums of the cities now. People who get used to it, you stay there and you don't ever leave because you don't ever see anything else. My grandmother would always say, you're not going to live on this farm. You're going to go to college. You're going to do something with your life. Or you're going to go to the military. And I was convinced to come to Marshall at that time.
Marshall was going through something like a 27-game losing streak. And they had made a commitment they were going to get the program turned around. So they started a recruiting program that took them all across the country. There were players that came in from New Jersey, Texas, Florida, Alabama, Georgia, you name it. They were bringing them in.
My brother Teddy, he was recruited by every major college in the country. My mom and dad were kind of overwhelmed with the situation. We never heard of Marshall University until Coach Moss, Perry Moss, came to the house. He was at the time coaching in professional football. He specialized in quarterbacks, in which Teddy was a quarterback. My mom and dad felt very comfortable with Coach Moss, and Teddy selected Marshall.
Many people said he was the best athlete they had ever seen. He played almost any sport that you can think of, but he excelled in baseball and football, and they wanted him to come to Marshall. And I said, well, we have all kinds of universities wanting different players on the team because it was a championship team. And I said, I'm sure that he would go down there if some of his friends could go with him. So he went to Marshall.
I think Marshall was hungry for a winning program. In the late 60s, you know, it's generally known that the black athletes, you know, nobody wanted to recruit too many of them because they were afraid of what the fans might do. I don't even remember who it was that made the comment, how many black athletes are y'all recruiting? And I said, well, I'm not recruiting any black athletes. I'm recruiting athletes. It doesn't matter to me. We wanted somebody that could score touchdowns.
My brother, Joe, he just had it all. He had the size, had the speed, the moves. It was just natural. Actually, when Joe finished high school, he came out as the number one athlete in the state of Alabama. I can remember he even had an interview with Bear Bryant. And he actually got on the campus and got out there to see Bear Bryant. Of course, everyone knows about Alabama and the discrimination and the prejudice that's here and in Alabama. And back in those days, they were just not ready for an athlete of Joe's caliber to be on the team. So Coach Red Dawson came down and to see Joe and actually ended up signing up all the guys together.
We were known as, you know, the guys from Alabama. I was recruited the following year on the freshman team. So when I turned 18 and got a scholarship to Marshall University, left home with three other guys, Joe Hood, Freddie Wilson, and Robert Van Horn. The four of us got into a 1962 Ford Falcon, which Freddie's father had bought him, and we took off headed to Huntington, West Virginia.
God bless America.
met my husband, Parker Ward, in the late 50s, and he was easing into the automobile business and was taking over the automobile agency on 4th Avenue. We were going to live here permanently and raise our family in Huntington. There was much industry at that time. International Nickel, Owens, Illinois, Houdal. They were such a large part of our community.
There was a time that Huntington was the largest city in West Virginia. It was a heavy industry city and one of the leading coal export inland ports in the country. But as far as the universities are concerned, Marshall was always a has-been and a throwaway institution, primarily because of underfinancing from the state of West Virginia. So it was unable to produce high-level sports teams. Had no place to play. The football team played in a public stadium they shared with two high schools. And some people got impatient. They brought in Perry Moss with the express purpose of taking a shortcut to establishing Marshall as a football power.
He knew how to win. He knew talent. And he was, you know, the football program had been in the doldrums for years and years and years. You know, he simply put, he was brought in here to win. And the difference was his attitude was to win at all costs.
Wait just a second, Don.
We won't raise that about this much.
Okay. Wait just a second. Y'all pick that one up even with that one. How's that?
Okay.
I got it? Good to see you.
This is Red Dawson.
How are you doing? Good to see you.
This is Richard Barber.
Richard. I came here in 1968. I was at Florida State as a graduate assistant coach, and I decided to take the first job offer I had. My first opportunity was with Perry Moss, coming to Marshall University as an assistant coach. The program had been going downhill for years, and it was my intention to help build a winner.
They brought in kids from areas that Marshall had never recruited from. They were super talented guys, guys that could have been playing at some big time schools across the country, and they came here. It was probably the greatest group of talent that was ever assembled at Marshall.
The number of recruits that we had had that year had been 125. We said, hey man, we're gonna take this place and we're gonna take it somewhere. But what we didn't realize at the time, we were really competing for scholarships. Many of us, even the ones who thought we had signed a scholarship, really had signed a loan. And I'll never forget, I started getting afraid of whether I had signed something that was the wrong thing myself.
A couple of the players complained about broken promises, that they were made several promises to come here to play football at Marshall, and they weren't being kept. And when they began to talk, that opened up the whole can of worms, and the school swung into action very, very, very quickly and launched its own investigation.
125 violations found. The NCAA alleged that they found that there were people getting $200, $300, $500 a week from a slush fund created by boosters. And sure enough, we had been kicked out of the Mid-American Conference. After the investigation, it was almost like I never really saw Perry Moss again. And they told us to hang in there, guys. Don't all everybody take off and run away. Maybe some of the lower level coaches may survive, and they would try to keep things going.
It was a trying time when he left. It was, you know, a lot was going on down there. A lot of people made phone calls to my parents, please don't let Teddy transfer out. His sophomore year was just, you know, even though they didn't have a winning record, the team showed promise of some great, great things to come. So a lot of them decided to stay, a few left.
seems, you know, last year I had all the problems and all, but it seemed like we're set this year, really, you know, really want to go. We know we can win this year. We just want to play ball.
In the search for a new coach, they were looking for a tough disciplinarian after the scandal to come in and have integrity and bring integrity to the program. And so Rick Tolley came in and bought his own team in, and he just kept Red and Mickey Jackson.
Rick Tolley asked me to stay, and by that time I had married a girl from here, and I'd kind of settled in here. We hadn't finished our job here. They still intended to build a program here, a winning program at Marshall.
It's stronger than what it was last year. Still not exactly what we want. We don't have enough depth, maybe size, but they're a good, hard-working young bunch of kids, and it will be better than last year.
When the 7th season began, we soon realized that we were not going to be big-time winners unless we had enough players. Rick was a fearless guy, big man. He never touched a player, but you would be ran to death or you'd be beat to death. We were glad for a game day, because that's the only time we stopped beating on each other and we got a chance to at least beat on somebody else. If you were hurt, you played. I was in a sling, and I played every game till a guy drove my ribs through my back cage, and that's what took me out of the game. We won 3 games. But it was a very, very tough year, and lots of people wanted to quit. Well, it was like, can we survive until the season's over? At the end of that season, we had the East Carolina game. That was a very big game, and the reason there was a lot of hype coming to that game is because it was going to be a flight. We were going to get a chance to fly. We thought that this flight would be good for everybody, and we thought we could beat East Carolina. And of course, I was going to be going on the trip until the coach said, hey, he said, I think I need some room for some boosters. And of course, that's where I got knocked out.
It was a special planned trip because we normally did not travel. Fans did not travel by chartered plane. In fact, I didn't remember that we had ever done that. But it just didn't seem like very long, you know, for my husband to be going on a trip. And I'm sure I would have been right there, but I'd just given birth to our 4th child. That's why I didn't go. But so many of my friends did, including many, many neighbors.
A total of 35 Marshall players made this trip to Greenville, North Carolina. It's a cloudy day, temperature in the high 50s. Marshall in their all-white uniforms with green helmets. Coyote Harris comes out to the 10, to the 15, to the 20, the 25, out to the 30, the 35 away, out to the 40, 20-yard line before he's piled under.
We were the only parents that made it to that game. And, of course, the boosters. And we sat with the boosters who had come down on the plane and who returned on the plane.
Bob Harris, the quarterback, the first half, and the Jersey Jets, Ted Shoebridge, the quarterback Marshall here in the second half. Here's the snap to Shoebridge, throwing long for Harris.
Mr. Shoebridge, who came to all of them, he was absolutely devastated because he didn't come to that last game.
There's no tremendous kid. So we're down to the hitting pretty of things. And Carolina will take it. Here it goes. 17 to 14 for East Carolina.
It was a close game. It was hard fought. And, you know, we made a good effort. We just didn't get the job done. The last time I saw any of the coaches or the players and the boosters was outside the dressing room after the game. I drove a university wagon down to the game, and I was trying to recruit a big linebacker at Ferrum Junior College. And so we were getting in the wagon, and we were going to head up towards Ferrum, and they were going to go back to Huntington.
it was raining. It rained about all day, I think. But I remember that evening that it was raining because, you know, we had listened to the game on the radio. And we were actually upstairs in the lounge shooting pool.
It was just a normal night. We had guys coming in from games they had covered. We had other people covering the normal stuff. Different shifts. I went out to dinner.
I was at a Keith Albee Theater. Why I even went, I don't think I was interested in the movie. But we was going to go back down to the stadium and wait on the team to come in. That was our plan.
Larry Sanders had given me $3 and told me, have me a six-pack of Coke 45 ready when I get back. So I had gone over, picked up the six-pack of beer, and was headed back to campus.
Southern 932, marker inbound.
Southern 932 is cleared to land. You can advise on the lights. The wind is now 340 degrees 7.
Very good.
Lights on the ground. Looks like fog.
Half the flash should be off to the left. Kind of hard to say, though.
We're in a rain shower, all right. See something?
No, no, not yet. 700 feet. Bugging 5. That'll be a Mr. Broach. 400.
Is that the approach?
Yep. 126. 100.
Sirens started sounding. I got a phone call from the lady who said, Jack, there's been a plane crash out here. I can see it out my kitchen window. It's got to be a big plane, a commercial plane. So I left the house here out toward the site. We went down a hill and up another one and down another one, you know, brushing away, trying to make a path to get through. And you think to yourself, my gosh, Jack, This is a dream. This didn't happen. I stepped over and boosted myself on what I thought was a tree stump, but it wasn't. It was a body. A firefighter came up to me and said, you know, Marshall was supposed to land about this time. And that's when I said, oh my God. And that's when it all started happening. And I spent the next 4 or 5 hours calling the paper every 10 minutes.
I received a phone call, and I was so startled. I mean, she just said, I just heard that this plane came in. She said, is that the one that Parker was on? And I was like, I know that I just couldn't answer. I mean, I just don't remember being able to say anything. I just hung up. You know, it was just, well, it just took my breath because I knew that. I mean, I knew, you know.
We drove straight out to Canova, to the airport. And as we were going up the hill, they were stopping people, said, you can't go any further. Can't go any further. We parked the car. We got out. And they couldn't stop us. It was just like, couldn't stop us. We were running. We said, we're players. We just kept going. And all we could do was wonder if anybody survived. You know, did somebody, maybe somebody's delirious and they got thrown out of the plane. Maybe if we could go look for them or something like that. This plane crashed at night in the side of a mountain going 200 miles an hour. There's nobody going to survive that, but nothing to stop you from hoping.
Well, our university is indescribably shocked. My heart goes out to the relatives and loved ones of our players and our staff and the fans. I can say that everything that could be done was being done. I saw no survivors, nor evidence of survivors.
This is just a tragedy that consumes us all, and these were beautiful young men. These were community leaders that were devoted to not only their university and their state, but it's just a tragedy that's beyond all comprehension.
You were still waiting on that call to say everything's going to be okay. You know, all the guys are going to be back here. But then the sun rose and there's a newspaper coming out and all this list of names and these pictures. And it was a real devastating time.
I walked in the living room and my mom was hysterical, crying with her, a couple of her sisters, and there were townspeople everywhere. And that's when they told me that the plane had crashed and they believe everyone was killed.
My mother ended up having a heart attack behind that. So we actually had to take her to the hospital. She didn't take it very well at all.
I had been directly involved in a lot of the boys that were on the plane, and I knew their families, I knew their parents. You can't imagine the guilt feelings that I had because I wasn't on the plane, and I don't know why that's the way it is. And maybe it was, you know, subconsciously I thought that, you know, I was part of the team and I should have been, you know, with the team.
There was 10 guys just off our floor had gotten killed in the crash. You had one payphone for that whole wing, and of course it was ringing nonstop with players' families calling up, wanting to know if their son had been on the plane. At night, and all of a sudden you hear this wailing out in the hallway, and there would be a girl sitting in a chair pounding on her dead boyfriend's door, calling his name. It was an experience where it made you have to grow up in a hurry. You know, I'm an 18-year-old kid that is shocked that all his friends are suddenly gone.
The thing that really haunts me to this day is after the game was over, my wife and I wanted the three boys to ride back to Huntington with us. And they were afraid because the coach was enraged because they had lost the game, and they didn't want to ask him. And that haunts me to this day that I didn't persist in getting them to ride up with us instead of going on the plane.
The aircraft came in here over this hill up to the left, hit those trees on top of the hill up there, caused the aircraft to actually hit the ground out here in almost a straight down, nose first attitude. The bodies were all right with the aircraft or in very close proximity of the aircraft.
We have a total of 75 bodies that we have recovered, and that we have them in refrigeration for further work toward identification.
The bodies are extremely charred. None can be identified physically. It's a physical impossibility.
They asked me if I would help recognize some of the bodies. So I was identifying players by that shoe belongs to so-and-so. I recognized rings, necklaces. And it's amazing what you see when you're in the locker room with guys every day. I recognize a thigh on a guy who was not burned. That's how we identified all of the bodies except for six.
Tonight, the world mourns. Students feel the pain so deeply that we cry and cry, for we should never dare to forget this.
You've lost not only a football team, you've lost some of your community leaders. We said bankers, lawyers, educators. The whole city was just in a pall of gloom and sadness. And there wasn't much laughter around here.
I was not physically strong enough to go to all these funerals. The only one, of course, I attended was my husband's. You can't dwell on the way things could have been. It's just one of these things that happens that change a lot of lives.
The tragedy has left me lost and in the greatest sorrow of my life. By the same token, it has left me with a heartfelt thanks for the son that gave me so much joy and love. I love you, my son, and I shall always continue to love you.
When we're picking flowers, we want to go out and pick the best flowers. And the Lord wants to do the same. And those are his flowers that he chose to pick.
I had nightmares. They didn't start to occur for about a month after the crash. And I couldn't sleep. And then that's when I became involved in doing drugs. It was the guilt thing of, you know, I should have died when they died. It was real rough life during that period of time. And my grandmother said, that's a terrible thing to happen to your friends. She says, but you got to get life started again.
If Marshall University was good enough for those guys to give their life for, it had to be good enough for me to stay there and play and help build the program, knowing that it was going to be a struggle because of where we were starting from. All right, here we go. Everybody on that field right there. Now, I wore the rings out for you again this morning. Hadn't had them on. Ring right here, Marshall University, Thundering Herd. Marshall University was the winningest football team in the 90s. Won more games than any college football team throughout the 90s. Coming from 1970, the year the plane crashed. 30 years ago, a plane crashed and killed a whole football team at Marshall University. Okay? That's why I was a freshman football player at that time. And the way we won these rings were with a group of guys that were willing to put it on the line and sacrifice anything that was asked of them to win. And that's what you got to do. And we could do it. Find your spot.
Let's go.
Here we go. Seniors. Let's get it done. Hit it running. Come on, sophomores. In the blink of an eye, I went from being one of the youngest players on the team to one of the oldest players on the team. All of a sudden, you feel that sense of just being lost, you know, because I had looked up to those guys. I mean, what do I do now?
Game week. Come on, 7-8.
The plane crash represented a severe setback. Do we drop football at Marshall University because it would be easy to do? They're not winning. Let's cut the losses, drop the program, put that money in something else. But then enough people made the decision not to do that and made a commitment that we'll have football at Marshall. We'll build a team from the ground. And Jack Lingle came in, started to try to mold us into a team.
I think that our program, starting with spring practice, we have an opportunity to exemplify what I think is one of the greatest lessons in athletics, and that's to face adversity, get back up off the ground, and go on to continued success. To this end, we're committed as an institution, as a town, and as a football team.
I always thought Dr. Donald Dedman had made me the acting head coach, but I was told later that no, that hadn't happened. And yet I felt an obligation to stay to a certain point. And we continued to try to recruit, which, looking back on it, probably was the best thing for any of us, you know, being connected to the program and having a tragedy like this happen. And the best thing that can keep your mind off your problems is hard work.
It was almost a joke to play Marshall because the team was built with my freshman class, the injured players that didn't make the trip, and walk-ons. They named us the Young Thundering Herd. The opening home game of the season, we played Xavier, people remember that game more than probably any game they've seen because it was so unbelievable. Beautiful day. It must have been 100 degrees down on the turf. And, the stadium is packed. I was a starting quarterback. You know, they were watching a new team, but you would see a number, and without even thinking, you start cheering for a guy that was dead. Late in the game, they went ahead, and we're going to get this ball one more time. And either we're going to make it happen on this one, or we're going to lose this game. So they call this play 5-13 bootleg screen. Now, I've dreamed about this moment, and when I took the snap, the gun sound. The official fired the gun. Game's over with. So I faked the dive into the line, bootlegged away, looked down the field. Here's Terry Gardner laying over in the flats. I dump it off to Terry. Terry Gardner takes it in the end zone. Touchdown. We upset him. People could not believe the fact that not only had Marshall put a team back on the field, they actually won the game.
People were in that ballpark for an hour after the game. They couldn't leave. Red Dawson up in the press box sends down the winning play. Now here's the guy that felt he should have been the head coach. Here's a guy who survived the tragedy. You see how things work out? It's crazy. He sends down the winning play. And it worked like a charm. And of course, what was the thing we were thinking about that night? About the plane crash.
You know, my career at Marshall was, the two worst years before the plane crash and the two toughest years after the plane crash. I guess it was, in my mind, it was time for me to leave the program. You know, I set out to become one of the great head football coaches of all time, but, it just didn't work out. Nobody called. So we had to go a different route. I had decided to take a job as a construction worker, but we put sewers in instead of calling plays.
First, it was like, are they ever going to be able to come back? How are they ever going to be able to have a winning program? It just doesn't seem possible. It seems too insurmountable. And they had a lot of losing seasons in a row, and they went through a lot of coaches. But it was a case where everybody wanted to do everything they could to help Marshall football come back. Finally, Stan Parrish had that first winning season, and there became that crack of daylight. Then that's when they grabbed the ball and ran with it. They saw that, hey, it's not hopeless. You know, it's not star-crossed. Football program can be a winner here. And once they saw that, and once they saw light at the end of the tunnel, then everything changed, and things changed in a hurry.
That crash humanized Marshall. We had flesh and blood people who lost their lives. If you'll check your calendars, almost, it was a slow thing, but began the transition of Marshall from a small, underfunded school to what it is today, began as a result of that plane crash. We suddenly began to get some help. And what you have is this great school you have today.
All three, hit and win. One, two, three,
hit and win.
Let's go, shock it off, let's go. Come on now.
The fans and the people of Huntington are really the reason that Marshall is successful now.
Nobody walk, let's go, come on. Five.
Hey, Steven, somebody break free, you gotta let it go. That's a sack. You ain't gonna get that ball off.
they've gone through the tough time. They're the ones that stayed here and fought this battle. And it was a long, painful process that it took a number of coaches, and I think each coach made a contribution to build our program.
7 seconds left of the MAC championship game. This is the right call. You pass, run pass option. Maybe some type of rollout by Pennington. Pennington looking, throwing, caught, touchdown! Marshall!
There's not anybody in the world would envision Marshall University as much as 4 years ago. Being 10th in the nation, have two different players that are Heisman Trophy finalists, and having games on national television. When I think about what's happened here, certainly I get teary-eyed, because it certainly is a miracle.
The second year in a row, they are the champions of the Motor City Bowl.
They're very aware of what's going on here in the past and what's going on right now. It's something that we don't necessarily dwell on every day, but it's in our hearts and minds. And what's happened at Marshall University is a true miracle. And I know some of those people are on that plane crash. They're looking down at us right now, and they're smiling. There's nobody who ever convinced me of that. That's not true.
Marshall is now coming about the recognition that it deserves, and having been a part of it, you know, I feel real good about having gone to Marshall. You know, there are some people that would say, hey, it's 30 years now, let it go. You know, how do you let that go? Through myself and people like me, they're gonna live on forever.
I feel real proud of the team. You know, 10 years ago, I never envisioned being able to go back to Florida State and bragging about the fact that I used to coach at Marshall, but that's a fact. I'm proud that I coached at Marshall.
I say
that's exactly
what it changed my entire life. You know, I look in the mirror and I'm 48 now. They're always forever young. They're always 18, 19, 20 years old in my mind.
It's not unusual for all the children to go to a game, and we are enjoying the present success. We just know that there are a lot of people that aren't here now that must just surely know how great things have gotten.
Still very much a part of us. But as the generations come along and time passes, it's just becoming a part of history. And I think that's where it belongs eventually.
They're a blessed school, and that's what I've continued to remind them, that curse has changed to a blessing, and you're now receiving it, and so you better enjoy it while it's there. We still believe there's a 12th player out there, and that 12th player is the people who died in the crash who are always pulling for you.
After November 14, 1970, Marshall University brought to mind one image, that of the tragic plane crash. But today it's known as the winningest college football team of the 90s. Finally, the program reached the level of success it set out to achieve 30 years ago. May they rest in peace. I'm Steve Cyphers for ESPN Classic.